Hello everybody, and we are live. This is Uptown Lockdown, the Duke Ellington Society UK online. My name's Anthony Pepper, George Duncan is here, Claire Foster is here, and we'll be back after we've heard Something to Live For.
I have almost everything a human could desire. Cars and houses, bearskin rugs to lie before my fire. But there's something missing, something isn't there. It seems I'm never kissing the one whom I could care for. I want something to live for, someone to make my life an adventurous dream. Someone who'd take my life and make it seem gay as they say it ought to be. Why can't I have love like that brought to me? My eyes are watching the new crowd, searching the promenade, seeking a clue to the one who will someday be mine. Something to live for.
Something to
wonderful Clare Foster that was. Something to live for. Clare Foster is a jazz vocalist and educator. Are you based in London?
No, just outside in an area called Essex. I'm sure you've heard.
An area called Essex, an area just outside London. Don't tell anybody, but just outside London there, one of the vaguely home counties there. And George Duncan is with us. Thank you so much for being here, George, as well. From where are you? You're just outside
Edinburgh.
Edinburgh, there we go, up in Scotland. Wonderful to see both of you. Thanks so much, Clare, for being here. Lovely. That was the Strayhorn, possibly also Ellington song, one of Strayhorn's first composer credits, recorded in 1939 there. Well, not there. That was from your album. When did you record that?
I'm thinking 20 years ago now.
Oh, good grief, yes. Well, I was just thinking that, I mean, you know, the scene passes one by, doesn't it? And very sadly, that was very gladly, that was Pete Jacobson on piano, now no longer with us, but very fondly remembered. So, yes, Clare is running a course on the songs of Duke Ellington starting next month, and we thought it would be great to have her along to talk about, exactly that subject. The lyrics and the songs that Duke and other people, the collaborators such as Strayhorn, wrote for the band over the years. And that one was 1939, originally featuring Ivy Anderson, who was the main singer with the band. And we'll get on to Ivy in a moment, but apart from your own piece there, your first selection is one of the earliest significant vocal numbers that Duke was involved with. A very special recording from 1927, featuring Adelaide Hall. Let's have a look here. Shall we play that and then talk about it after we've heard it?
Oh,
Creole Love Call at Adelaide Hall with the Ellington Orchestra in 1927 wordless singing, a unique piece really, certainly for that period. Clare, tell us a bit about why that piece is important to you.
Well, I think it just has a load of history. I mean, you mentioned wordless singing. We've got the lyric, we've got the wordless singing, the universal voice just making sound. So I think these singers really kind of paved the way and were, you know, influencing so many singers. So that's kind of starting there is a good place, I think.
I agree. Yes, it's certainly one of the most significant pieces. It's obviously a very, just to mention, it's a very commonly referenced piece, but such a great work. The melody may not be an Ellington piece, and the story on that is somewhat well rehearsed, so we needn't go into that right now. But the conception, if not the absolute melodic composition there, all Duke, really. And, of course, Adelaide. Now, Adelaide was resident in London for many years, and one of our guests a few weeks ago, Earl Oakin, knew her well. So it's great to hear her there. And this is at a time when, although the band was just, at the time that was recorded, I believe just taking up their residency at the Cotton Club in Harlem. Just try to check these things, because I'm always just, you know. I know that people will be shouting at their screens and so on. Yes, okay. So that was recorded just before the band took up its residency. Just before the band took up its residency at the Cotton Club in Harlem there in the autumn of 1927. The band didn't have a singer, a regular singer. There were records made with various singers at the time, and that session with Adelaide Hall was one of those. But at the time, Ellington probably didn't feel that he needed a singer. But moving on into the 1930s, and the band got its first regular singer, and in February 1932, she, Ivy Anderson, made her first recording. Now, this is, you know, one of the great pieces, one of the great masterworks, really, in terms of composition, the orchestration, and Ivy's performance. Shall we hear this and then come back and talk a little bit about it?
What I do, da da do, da da do. Thank you.
Anderson as part of the Duke Ellington Orchestra there in 1932. George?
Well, I, showing my ignorance here, being a boy from the sticks, way up here in Scotland, I'm sure the audience know everything there is to know about our wonderful guest, Clare Foster, today. But I just, you know, showing my ignorance, and I just wanted
well,
to ask you...
Well, George is in a different country, so, you know.
And, you know, what were your influences?
Okay, so my dad, who's still alive, he didn't believe there was any jazz after 1932. Uh-huh. So I was brought up on Bessie Smith, Bix Beiderbecke, mm-hmm. Loads and loads of the early singers. I mean, literally, I spent all my pocket money getting on a train, going up to London, going to the record stores and buying 1920s albums, the earliest recordings. So I listened to all of those singers, and I couldn't, I mean, they didn't sound like me or any of that, but I actually didn't like jazz at the beginning, because my dad would put the music on and he'd have some drinks, and I would just always think of jazz and my dad getting kind of sad. Yes, yes. And so I didn't really enjoy it. And then I started to play the clarinet when I was about 13, and I really got into the melodies of the old standards. So I would just pull out all the old singers and listen to them all. Quite unusual to be doing at that time, but that's what I did.
Right. Well, it's a pity Frank Griffiths isn't here today, because of course he would have got his clarinet out and
could have had battling clarinets.
Do you still play at all?
Sorry?
Do you still play the clarinet?
No, I don't anymore. No, I don't anymore. And I think if I was going to pick a singer that influenced me the most in that time, it would have been Fats Waller and Hoagy Carmichael.
Oh, yes.
I think they were the two, and Fats Waller, he was like the Stevie Wonder, you know, mm-hmm. everything he touches just sounds great. And I still think that, and I still listen to him, and I think, what a talent, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's a great analogy, yes. I love that. Yeah, so no, I mean, Fats obviously turned a lot of not so golden things into gold, didn't he? It's quite a thing. So many, made so many vocal records in the 1930s, and one or two earlier on as well. And of course, Greg's such a wonderful pianist, too. I was just listening the other day to some of the London Suite again, which he recorded in London in 39. So, yes. Oh, amazing. Good question, George. Fantastic.
Well,
thank you.
I seriously am interested. And, of course, I'm also interested in the fact that you've been reasonably close to London, I think. Who did you see? What concerts did you go to that perhaps?
Well, I moved out of England for about 9 years. So I moved to New York when I was... 18 and a half, 19. And so I suppose the biggest influence there was attending the Barry Harris workshops. Barry Harris used to run these workshops for singers. And I used to go there, and I was just like a walking sponge, because he would run them in a very casual way, but he was very serious about what he was teaching. And he would have Wes Montgomery's drummer on, you know, it was like, you know, to be around these people and just listening to him giving feedback. And he was one of those pianists that knew the verses, not just the songs in any key. He knew the verses to all the songs. And so that was kind of my journey into jazz, really.
And a very good one. So,
well, I was only there for a year. Then I moved, came back to London for a couple, and then I went to Holland, and then to Canada.
My goodness
me! Wow.
Well travelled, yes.
Mm.
and singing all the way.
Singing all the way, as hard as it was, but I did it anyway.
Oh, super.
Yeah.
Yes, how was Holland then? Holland certainly has a
jazz connection. Yeah, it was amazing because we were in the same position we're in now. We can't get to Europe easily, so we were then not able to get to Europe. We didn't feel like we were really part of Europe. And so when you're in Holland, you're next door to Belgium, next door to Germany. So for me, I went there and started to run a singer's vocal night every week. I did it for 5 years, actually, and toured around, did the gigs, you know, the Bim House, the different gigs in Holland and such, yeah.
Oh, goodness me, fantastic. Yes. And then over to Canada.
Oh, well, then I went to Singapore for a while, had a residency there for a while, and then from Singapore came back to Holland and then went to Toronto for a couple of years.
Well, you know, aren't you glad you did that? Because everybody's now locked in their houses almost, hopefully that won't be forever, but... Oh, dear me, yes.
It's been interesting in this lockdown because there's been a lot of people from my past, and I'm sure everyone's experienced this, people reaching out. So I've actually connected with nearly everyone I've met in my life, not everyone, but it's been very interesting. Yeah, very interesting.
Yes. So it's opened up a lot of opportunities, but it would be nice to actually converse in person with people again, wouldn't it? So the Ellingtons are picking up the thread of the Ellington career. We'll just mention that Herb Jeffries joined the band and recorded a piece called Flamingo. But the next piece we're going to hear, because just going through the Ellington vocalists, as it were, is a piece that on the studio record features Ray Nance from 1941, I think. Biblip. Shall we hear that? And then we can just mention a bit about that. Because Ray Nance joined as a trumpeter and then, you know, was featured in Take the A-Train. And it turned out that he could also sing and play violin and dance a bit as well. So a very useful acquisition for the Ellington Orchestra. But here he is with the band and the studio version of Biblip.
Love to you is true, on the kind you can do. Bib, bib, bade, bam, 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 hip to bab do. My poor heart gives a start, like a jitterbug just won't stop. Mix my spooning with your crooning, watch me blow my tune. Wow! Love to you I've sworn, on account of mine is yourn. Bib, bib, bade, bam, 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 hip de babble do bad. Thank you. Bip, bip, a vade, flam, flam, flam. Hip, to bop, a doo.
Bip, blip. Rain dance, wonderful rain dance. In 1941, from Jump for Joy. But I'm not, I think possibly in the show, but certainly in the film that was made, not Ray Nance, but Paul White and is it a Marie Bryant? They're featured, aren't they? There's a short film, a soundie. So my understanding of these is a bit like a kind of visual jukebox, you know. So you would go to a venue and put, you know, a small coin in and it would play this film for you, you know. So they made that film about 43 possibly? And well worth, isn't it, Claire? Well worth seeking out.
Yes, definitely, definitely.
Yes, you see them dancing around and also performing with the band there. I'm not sure if it's really a little glimpse into Jump for Joy, but Jump for Joy was a show that Duke had on in Hollywood for quite a time in 1941, and it didn't transfer anywhere, but it occupied the band for quite a while. And there's not much, well, I don't certainly, there's not much recorded as to how the show actually was, you know. There are the studio records, and that's almost it, you know, things like that and Jump for Joy, of course, title piece. So right, okay. So Ray Nance, such a sort of quadruple threat in the Ellington band there, as a trumpeter, singer, violinist, when called upon. They did it. I don't think we're going to play it, but they produced a wonderful version of the piece that we heard, the original recording of It Don't Mean a Thing. Probably a stray horn arrangement about 1943, didn't they? Which is a super piece to, you know, this kind of a jam piece that they did. A jam arrangement, really. And that features Ray Nance pretty strongly.
I think what was interesting about that recording, Anthony, is that the solo that Ray sings is so much a Betty Roche pulls from that solo. So I think it was a very much an influence, that particular recording with Ray Nance.
Right.
Because I actually hadn't heard that recording, but I'd heard Betty Roche.
Oh, right.
And I didn't know that Betty Roche was drawing from Ray Nance. So that was interesting for me.
Right, that is interesting, yes. Where are we wandering off to next? Because we do have some Betty Roche. But Betty Roche was in the band twice, or at least it was involved with the band twice. And both of those periods don't produce much in the way of recorded evidence of that. Mm-hmm. But what they do produce is pretty significant. Let's just see here. Or shall we? Because actually in the order that I've got here, we're going on to a piece of music which was recorded as an instrumental. Indeed, a lot of the Ellington songs are instrumentals originally, aren't they? So Sophisticated Lady, Mood Indigo, Spring to Mind, but also In a Sentimental Mood.
Mm-hmm.
And... This is jumping ahead in the chronology quite a bit here, but shall we do that? Shall we go to In a Sentimental Mood? Or shall we... Because Betty Roche, I've got it in slightly later in the list here, I think. So John Coltrane and Duke Ellington made an album together. The famous piece is... it's not really a famous... so much a famous piece. This is probably actually the famous piece, but I just love the title, Take the Coltrane. So it's a famous title to me at any rate. But In a Sentimental Mood, fantastic arrangement of this, although not a vocal arrangement at the time. featuring Duke, possibly, I think Aaron Bell on bass. Is it Elvin Jones drums?
Mm-hmm.
And John Coltrane. So yes, let's play this and then sort out what we're doing with Betty Rossi, okay? In a sentimental mood. John Coltrane and Duke Ellington. Just in between, and many of the best bits of this programme are not in fact broadcast, but you were talking about Ellington's ballads there. Just repeat some of what you were saying, Claire.
Yeah, I look at them as being like the Rolls Royces of the American songbook as far as ballads are concerned. They're just, when I first heard Sophisticated Lady and In a Sentimental Mood and Prelude to a Kiss, I thought, my God, somebody wrote this. It's amazing. There's just something very special. It's like a shining jewel amongst all those songs. So for me, they're not for the lighthearted. They're pretty hard to sing. But when you do manage to get your technique around them, they're amazing pieces. And you don't have to do much with them to make them amazing, because they're such masterpieces on their own. Mm-hmm. So that's what I feel about his ballads.
Fantastic. And then when Strayhorn joined the organisation, not quite mm-hmm. joining the band, that added a unique sort of second voice and much of Strayhorn's probably greatest writing is in the sort of, it's in the lush orchestrations for ballad pieces, mm. you know. And we may get back to some of that. Strayhorn wrote Take the A-Train. Now, I have two versions of this. We were just talking about Betty Rushe. I've got a version, I believe, where she's doing it on her own, but also with the Ellington Orchestra. Shall we hear the version that she did with the Ellington Band in the early 50s?
Mm.
So Betty Rushe joined and was featured on the blues section of Brown, from Black, Brown and Beige in 1943. But that coincided with this first of the several 1940s recording strikes that there were in America. So by the time that the band actually recorded that as a piece, almost 2 years later, she had been replaced by Joya Sherrill. I believe that's the right, I believe that's the fact there. But later on, she was back and featured on this very remarkable version of the Billy Strayhorn composition. Not a ballad, but the Billy Strayhorn composition, Take the A-Train.
Get to Harlem. If you should take the A train, you'd find it. You'll get where you're going if you hurry. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Now it's coming. Ooh, ooh. Can't you hear? The rails are humming. Get with it. If you should take the A train, you'd find it, you get where you're going if you hurry. Shadot blobber to your dub, sweat blobber to your dub, ooh, you cool. Shadot dobber to your dub, sweat blobber, dub, shabby doo, doo, ow. I ain't mad at you, pretty baby, don't be mad at me. Oh, pop, shabam, cookie mop, shabby oop, dooby oop, doo, ow. Swiss, swabby, doo, doo, doo. Sweet, 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 Shabby doo doo ba doo ya duck, swear flop doo ya duck, doo ba doo, em doo. Swab a ba doo ya duck, swab em doo, and duck, doo ya duck, doo ya duck, doo ya duck, ba dan. Em flop a doo ya duck, swab swab a doo, flop a doo ya duck, em doo. Shot shab a dot, em flop a doo ya duck, swab swab a doo. Swab a doo ya doo ya doo ya doo ya doo ba dee ya, swab doo ba doo ba doo ya. Lyra is the face. Ya do be do be do be do sweet be do be do. I ain't much to look at, ain't nothing to see. I've got a train waiting for me. I'm waiting for the day train.
Betty Rocher and the Duke Ellington Orchestra, 1952, I think that was, and Take the A Train. So we're just mentioning about Ella and Ella's recording of this, just for contrast. What a great singer Ella is. So tell us a bit about that, Claire.
Yeah, well, I was very, very influenced by Ella when I started out singing. I mean, the perfect voice, seamless, and I collected all the Verve recordings, and she had two double albums of Ella and Ellington, and they're just brilliant. They're still so brilliant. And the solo that she sings on A-Train is in itself a work of art. It's a piece in itself. In fact, I have taken that very solo and I've reharmonized and done some stuff with it, because it's such a great example of a fantastic improvisation over the chords of A-Train. So yeah, I totally, that and Perdido, she does another great improvisation on that. There's so much on those albums that's brilliant. And so I do recommend anyone who loves Ella and loves Duke Ellington to get those albums.
Sugar Hill, way up in Harlem. If you miss the A train, you'll find you've missed the quickest way to Harlem. Hurry, get on, now it's coming. Listen to those rails a-thrumming. All aboard, get on the A train. Soon you will be on Sugar Hill in Harlem.
Thank you.
sugar go to Sugar Hill way up in Harlem. You must take the A train to go to Sugar Hill way up in Harlem. If you miss the A train, you've missed the quickest way to Harlem. Hurry, get on board, it's coming. Listen to those rails are drumming. All aboard, get on the A train. Soon you will be on Sugar Hill in Harlem. Oh, all aboard, next stop is Harlem. Stop is Harlem, take the A train.
Disappearing off into the distance there, take the A train, Ella Fitzgerald with the Duke Ellington Orchestra. So again, we were just saying about the opportunities that lockdown has provided. Obviously, there's this program, but the ability to teach online. Claire, say something on the differences between teaching online and perhaps in person, for instance, at the City Lit in London.
I think that there's a certain, there's a different focus that happens online. The detail that sometimes gets missed in classes, even though you can repeat yourself and such, I think that online there is just a, there's a detail that that I've noticed my lovely students have really benefited from. And at the beginning, I thought it would be very difficult to do, but I find it a joy, and I really look forward to it. There's much to be got from it, and of course when we meet in person it'll be different and such, but not to be taken for granted. You can always make something very constructive out of online teaching. I found it to be very fulfilling. Oh, and so fulfilling that I've been doing, well, it's the second course, the Ellington course that I plan to do. It's called More Ellington Vocal Course, and it's on the 14th of April to the 19th of May. And it's basically learning six-session course, and it's learning six other Ellington tunes. And when we learn them, then things will come up in the class, and you know, how the song is constructed and how we can get around working with semitones and staying in tune and all the things, you know, the things that come at us as a challenge when we're learning new songs. So that's something that I've got in the pipeline.
Right, yes, and really exciting. You've just finished a six-week course, and so successful, you're doing another one with another six songs.
Yes.
So Biblip's going to be one of those. What other songs would you be including? You don't have to list them all, but just...
No. Well, that would be telling if I told you. But But their ones, Prelude to a Kiss is one of them.
Okay.
Join the course and find out.
They were, so in 3 weeks' time, on a Wednesday afternoon, a bit earlier than this, anywhere in the world. If people wish to find out more about that, they can go to your website, which is, I think, what do you tell us? ClareFosterMusic.com, is that right?
Yeah,
I've got that right. ClareFosterMusic.com.
I'm on Instagram and I'm on Facebook, and so you can always contact me.
Yeah, so if you go to ClareFosterMusic.com and click on contact or something like that,
that's it.
There's a phone numbers and email address there, so you can contact Claire directly and get more details about that.
Yeah.
And in case people are put off, the cost is £120 for 6 weeks, is that right? Which is
2 hours, two-hour class.
Not desperately expensive, I might just say. So honestly, I would, if I was an up-and-coming singer or somebody who wanted a little bit more, I don't know. I mean, what do you tell us about the kind of profile of the the students that you get?
Well, I teach at the City Literary Institute, as you know, and I've been there for quite a while. And I also run my own private classes in London, like master classes. So it's a mix of people. I've been teaching now for like 22 years. So I have, for instance, on the last Ellington, I had a lady that's known me a while from Italy join. And I've had someone from Germany that may join this Ellington. So it's London is like a big melting pot. Everyone comes through it, goes out, stays or goes. It's just a mix of people, very interesting people, and mostly serious about what they're doing, which is very good. It feeds for both of us, teacher and student.
Brilliant. Fantastic stuff. Where should we go now musically?
Well, we've got Money Jungle was another one mentioned.
Oh yes, indeed. So you select. I'm so sorry. The Zoom thing just caused an audio conflict there. Say that again. Sorry.
Yeah, Money Jungle was one, and then I mean that maybe go there.
Yes. So
the influence of Thelonious Monk with the Ellington. I mean, the young Ellington sounds remarkable.
Shall we hear a bit of Monk? Because Monk did this album in 1955.
Yeah, that's right.
Plays the music of Duke Ellington. So he was pretty young still then. I mean, he came up on the scene about 10 years earlier, didn't he, I guess? Mid-40s, I suppose. And in fact, a piece I've selected from this album, kind of not completely at random, I Got It Bad, and That Ain't Good, which is actually another number from Jump for Joy from 1941.
This is the one that's mid-tempo, isn't it?
One of the great features for Ivy, of course, right towards the end of her career. We heard the start of her career there. Unfortunately, Ivy was forced out of the band with asthma in the early 40s there. But shall we hear this? This is Thelonious Monk. I think it's 1955, and I Got It Bad. Thelonious Monk in the mid-50s. And we were just wondering, weren't you? But I think you probably persuaded us too that there may be a slight incongruousness, hang on, in the tempo there that they move into, slightly up-tempo and possibly happy. Quite an effective performance, even so. Compared with the lyric on the original song, which of course is an Ivy Anderson feature, or at least it is on the record. I imagine it was live as well, in 1941. So that was Thelonious Monk plays Duke Ellington. Moving a little bit along, not Thelonious Monk, but Duke Ellington playing Duke Ellington, but with a couple of other modern musicians, Charlie Mingus and Max Roach. So one of the slow pieces here you've chosen from Money Jungle. Flirt African. Flirt African, little African flower, I suppose, from Money Jungle there. So that, you know, Duke are holding his own with the other modernists there. Well, all jazz is modern, isn't it? That's the thing that people do sometimes forget, I think, at the time, you know, throughout. People talk about modern jazz and so on. But as you were saying, you were getting into the earlier music, which was certainly fairly modern at the time. Although even, to be fair, even by the 20s, there was a sort of tradition that had already been established, wasn't there? And so, yes, there we go. That was the early, 62, I think, early 1960, something like that. So interesting to hear Monk and then to hear particularly Charlie Mingus there. And you mentioned that Charlie wrote a couple, Charles, as he later became, he says Charlie on the record there. He wrote a couple of pieces. Well, he wrote Duke Ellington's Sound of Love and also a piece for Harry Carney. What was that album called, the thing that it came out of? In the early 1970s. I looked that up.
Hmm.
But anyway, much later music. But wonderful and fascinating stuff. Now, we are together here today because of a connection with somebody that we both know called Sue Jarvis. Hello, Sue, if you're watching, listening. Hope you are. And she appears on your latest CD, which we really must get on and mention.
Yes, so this is a new album, and it's a real celebration of my love of the American songbook and my love of Latin and especially Brazilian music. So there's three originals on it, but there's 15 tracks on the album and 13 of them are standards. 12 of them are standards and three of them are originals. And they're songs that I love that most of them were, in fact, all of them really were arranged either together or by my partner. His knowledge of world music is very great. So he did some wonderful arrangements, and I invited Sue. She'd written lyrics to a song I'd written years ago called Quem Canta Os Males Espanta, which is a saying in Brazil and in Portugal, those that sing send their worries away. And I'd asked Sue to put some Brazilian lyrics to it because she speaks fluent Portuguese. And this opportunity to record it and to get her to sing with me on it came about, and in fact it's being played around the world at the moment and it's being picked as the number one track, so I'm quite pleased about that. We have this laugh, Sue and I, that we'll be buying a castle in Spain on that one track, and it's getting there, like we've got the door. Well, nearly. Not quite the castle, but so yes, it's if you don't like jazz, you might like this.
Ooh.
And if you like Latin music and you don't, you know, it kind of crosses over where it's got something in it for the Latin and the jazz, but it is a jazz Latin. I'm not trying to be a Latin singer, but the rhythms are very strict. They're not just jazz-ish. They are strictly written, the arrangement. So if you're a connoisseur and you really want it done properly, then you'll get that if you listen to this album. And you might learn a thing or two. Mm. You might learn what a curralau is or a candombe or et cetera. Yeah.
Fantastic. So hold it up again.
So yeah.
So where can people find... Oh, that's great, just in front of your face. That's excellent, okay. Shot. yes, and a lovely cover. Oh, I'm so sorry. A lovely cover there as well.
Yeah, you can buy it on Bandcamp, clairefoster.bandcamp.com, and physical copies I have. It's already, the physical copies are also on Bandcamp as well. So you can buy it through me or through Bandcamp, and my other albums are on there as well, so you can see what I've done.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And all of this is available, links to it are available through your website, clairefostermusic.com.
We will be updating my website. It's out of date. So
that's the thing about websites.
That, That is, yeah. Everything always comes out of date. It comes around eventually, but this, probably in the world of internet, it won't come around again. It needs to be updated. So, you know, go on there and press the contact, but I haven't actually loaded that new CD up because we're going to do a whole new website.
Okay. But otherwise, at Bandcamp, give us that address again.
Yeah, it's clarefoster.bandcamp.com.
Okay, couldn't be... Is it great? Okay.
All right. Yeah, if you go, Bandcamp is a digital place to buy albums, so it'll be there.
Fantastic. And was this recorded during the lockdown? And
it was recorded actually in a studio, and then we did the vocals and brought some other instruments in because we do something on just one of those things called a bomba, and it's a full band. A lot of salsa kind of sounding horn section. So it was done at home, some of it, but some of it in a studio.
Fantastic.
But all finished in lockdown. If we hadn't locked down, I probably wouldn't have finished it. We were speaking here about lockdown in this family has been quite a good thing. We've been able to finish things and do things that we put on the back burner for so long.
Well, there have been multiple aspects for it, and as somebody or other said, it's an ill wind, you know. So there's always something, isn't there? You've got to try to find the positives, and certainly there'll be a lot. I mean, talking about, you know, the education online, there'll be a lot of the online things, I imagine, feeding in to the future, even when people do physically, you know, trek, as you said, mentioned, trek into London and that kind of thing. So, yes, right, good. Where shall we go now, musically? We do have your recording of Daydream here. Shall we play that?
Yeah, you could do that.
This is a lovely piece, of course, obviously. Although I think also, like Something to Live For, credited to Ellington and Strayhorn, but generally considered to be a Strayhorn ballad, originally recorded as a Johnny Hodges feature in 1940. And then I'm not sure if the lyric was added immediately, but a lyric was added. Again, another instrumental piece in the Ellington repertoire.
Well, there
originally.
Is a verse to the verse on this. So that verse, I'm pretty sure the lyric and the melody were written together, right. I think.
So who's on this recording?
Andrew McCormack, Alec Dankworth, Winston Clifford, Jean Toussaint, I can't remember now if he's on this actual track. was it just the trio? I think it's just the trio, Andrew. And then I think so, yeah.
Okay.
That I feel now, can't keep my feet on the ground. Everything seems unreal now when you're not. Deep in a rosy glow, the face of my love you show. Daydream, I walk along on air, building a castle there for me and my love to share. Till of my love you show. Daydream, I walk along on air, building a castle there for me and my love to share.
Oh, Clare, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Anthony.
That was beautiful, lovely trio and you there. And that's from an album called, what is that called?
The Music and I.
Which can also be found at clarefoster.bandcamp.com. Oh, super. So, yes, so Ellington's songs overall are, I think it's fair to say, because there's so much other material, a little bit overlooked sometimes, but there's certain, well, I think that's fair to say, isn't it, sometimes? And so, Duke and Billy and other people, there's a significant body of vocal work there, and there are people we didn't touch on today, Kay Davis particularly, that comes to mind, in the non-vocal side of things. We heard Ella, we heard Betty Roche, and obviously Addy and Ivy, and others, so great. What are we going to finish with?
Well, I'd like to finish with Peggy Lee, I'm Gonna Go Fishing. I like that track a lot, and that's an Ellington track, very modern.
Let's play that out then. So again, very much appreciated. George, thank you so much for being here as well.
No, I've loved this afternoon. Thank you, Clare.
Thank you, George. Lovely. We'll be in touch. Yeah, we will.
And hopefully,
when we get, when the lockdown finishes.
Oh, when the lockdown. Yeah, just before we go, I mean, hopefully there'll be chances to actually see you. Oh, sorry, George.
No, I was just saying when lockdown finishes and we get down to London and go to Ronnie's, etc., we may all meet up. Who knows?
Be great. Yeah, be lovely. Or yes. Perhaps I'll be Scotland before you're down here.
Yes.
So when the lockdown,
you haven't sung?
I haven't sung up in Scotland. I was invited up by a guy called Casper Ninterman. Do you know Casper Ninterman? Oh. Right up, long way up in Scotland. I can't remember the area, but it wasn't just, I know Alec Dankworth was going to do it, and it just wasn't paying enough. Right. To do the schlepping, so
it is another country up there, isn't it? Yes.
Well, you have to get a grant, basically. You have to get a grant to get, the subsidies to make those things work, don't you?
So just before we go, when the lockdown is actually over and everything, where will people be likely to be able to actually see you perform? Which, of course, would be a wonderful thing, a delightful thing to happen.
Yeah, I'd like it to be on every big stage in the world. So yeah. That's just keep your eye on every big stage in the world and you'll see me at some point.
Fantastic.
But don't close your eyes because you might miss me.
Ooh, okay. So here then, here is Peggy Lee. Okay.
Woke up this morning, wanted to cry. Then I remembered, yes, I knew why. He's a real good one for having his cake. I'm gonna go fishing or jump in the lake. Yes, I'm gonna go fishing, that's what I'll do. Think about nothing, not even you. Catch a real big one, a big speckled trout. Snapping in the water, I'll pull him on out. Sweet talking liar, spin me a yarn. Tell me a story, big as a barn. Don't stop listening, I won't hear you out. I'm gonna go fishing and catch me a trout. If a man is a liar, a man is a fool. Playing for keepers and breaking the rule. He'll be the loser, yes, he'll find out. I'm gonna go fishing and catch me a trout. Here in the water, look at him shine. There goes a big one, that one is mine. Cast off the reel now, I got the feel now. Snap, got the fine fly rod, or catch me a trout. Yes, sweet talking liar, you're in for a fall. You tell me a story, you talk to the wall. On down the highway, I'm gonna go fishing and catch me a trout. I'm gonna go fishing and catch me a trout. I'm gonna go fishing and catch me a trout. I'm gonna go fishing and catch me a trout.